Let me welcome everyone to this latest spring colloquium of the Center for Studies in Higher Education. I'm Michael Nacht, Interim Director of the Center, and it's a real treat for me today to just begin with a few introductory remarks about our speakers on a subject that's of enormous importance. We've all been living through changes in distance learning and online education for some time. Some prognosticators thought it might even be the end of the physical university. Hasn't quite worked out that way. But you're going to hear from some real experts today. Let me introduce them to you, though you have bio information about them. So I'll just briefly summarize a few key points. Diana Wu, as I'm sure most people from Berkeley know, has been dean of the UC Berkeley Extension for 9 years. But in addition, she is the founding executive director of the Berkeley Resource Center for Online Education, which was created 5 years ago to serve Berkeley's campus, which brings 45 full-time staff working with faculty in schools and departments throughout the university to support online innovation and build online education courses, including MOOCs, massive open online courses, credit courses, certificate programs, and master's degree programs. And there's a lot more that she may tell you about that. So she's going to provide a kind of Berkeley perspective on distance learning. We're very happy to have returned to us Mitchell Stevens, who's a friend of the center. He's associate professor of education and sociology at Stanford, and he serves as director of data policy for the vice provost for teaching and learning and founding director of the Center for Advanced Research through Online Learning. He's organized a key colloquia. He's published on the subject. And he's a very lively and interesting and iconoclastic, if I might say, speaker. In addition, we're joined by a Cal PhD student, Ben Gebra Medin, who's a PhD candidate in sociology who's working on this subject. He has co-published with Mitchell Association Service Market, Higher Education and American Political Development. And he's particularly working now on how status is contested and instability is managed in elite universities with an empirical focus on how Stanford, MIT, Harvard, and Berkeley produced and responded to the MOOC movement of 2012. So the batting order will be our guest Mitchell will lead off, and then Diana will follow, and then Ben will come in and lead them in a discussion and offer his own thoughts. We'll try to end all of that by about 10 to 1, allowing 15 or so minutes of Q&A, followed by, thanks to Diana, a sumptuous luncheon. Mitchell.
I think we all know that the San Francisco Bay Area and Northern California are much better places because both Stanford and Berkeley are here, because we contribute to an organizational population that has well over 350 colleges and universities. As we move forward into very interesting but uncertain times, I and many of my colleagues at Stanford are committed to doing that in relationship with our partners and friends all over the region. So I always learn something. I'm grateful to come back. I have the great pleasure of working at that place. It photographs very well. And it should, because Frederick Law Olmsted and H.H. Richardson and their colleagues were hired by Jane and Leland Stanford to build a campus that would impress a skeptical Eastern establishment. Right? For most of the recorded history of higher learning, to create a center of learning meant to build a physical place where teachers and learners and artifacts of knowledge, usually in the form of texts, could be placed into a particular setting. Right? And you went to that place to teach and learn and study. There was a fundamental instrumental purpose for the physical co-presence of students and teachers and objects. But of course, it wasn't just an instrumental purpose. Physical co-presence is never just an instrumental purpose. It also has highly symbolic purposes, right? Mothers and fathers and grandparents and aunts and uncles and cousins do not pay exorbitant hotel rates in Berkeley and Palo Alto every June to sit in the sun and watch their children don medieval gowns for instrumental purposes, right? Teaching and learning and research are also deeply ceremonial projects. They're rituals in which we remind each other about things that we care about that don't take place in other social institutions. We know that as educators deep down inside, that physical co-presence is both an excellent way of delivering some forms of instruction and learning, but it also has a very important ceremonial and ritual component. It's only been in the last very short period of time that it's been possible to imagine teaching and learning and research without physical co-presence. It's only been in a short shard of historical time that it's been possible to think that higher learning and research inquiry could happen without bricks and mortar. And that's thrilling, but it's also excruciatingly painful for a great many educators, like myself, who have invested a lot in the symbology and ceremony of physical co-presence, right? We love our campuses, we love our departments, we love our students, we love our schools. And at the same time that digital media have made it possible for us to imagine other forms of doing academic work together, a lot of us have anxieties that something fundamental will be lost if we make physical co-presence a merely provisional part of the enterprise of higher education. That's my thumbnail anthropological diagnosis for why online learning is providing, it's creating so much anxiety. It's not the only diagnosis by any means. Another part of the anxiety is that a lot of organizations that are not schools, that don't even want to be schools, have the temerity to be offering something called higher learning. And we're not at all sure that those organizations, often whose ownership is publicly traded on Wall Street, should be allowed to offer something called higher learning. That's another part of the mix. Now, Ben Gebremedin is writing a beautiful comparative dissertation about the emergence of massively open online courses in 2012 in the San Francisco Bay Area and in the Boston-Cambridge metropolitan area. And I'm convinced that it's going to tell us a lot, give us a lot of counterintuitive insight about a moment that we all lived through, but can only see from our limited single-person perspectives. Until his dissertation is done, the story that I'm going to tell about Stanford can be nicely elaborated by an article that Ken Aletta wrote in the New Yorker magazine in April of 2012 called, not inappropriately, Get Rich You. Right, about that place, Stanford. So I'm going to give, what I'm going to do in the next few minutes is provide a very, very brief schematic account of the history of distance learning at Stanford, which goes back a lot further than you may think, to 1954, in fact. I'm going to give a very schematic account of the history of distance learning at Stanford from 1954 to, like, today. I promise, it'll be like four slides, all pictures, no tests. The reason I want to do that is I want to, and I think Diana is going to pick up on some of this as well. I think it's important to remind ourselves that the idea of distance learning is not new. That Berkeley and Stanford and Harvard and Dartmouth and Cornell and many of our peer institutions have been engaged in distance learning for many years, in fact, for decades. Something changed in 2012, and I'll conclude my brief remarks with that thing that changed. But I want to emphasize here a kind of historical continuity to perhaps give the anxiety that many of us are feeling about distance learning at this moment a little bit of comfort and succor. Okay. All right. So this is Frederick Terman. He trained on the East Coast under Vannevar Bush. You've heard of Vannevar Bush, yeah? A very ambitious engineer who served both as provost, a dean of the School of Engineering and provost at Stanford for many years. And the institution that he arrived at in Palo Alto in the years before the Second World War, he found a gentleman and women's university, a place where you could respectably send your son or daughter and their horse, if they had one, in the affluent countryside south of San Francisco. The real brains were at Berkeley and Harvard and MIT and Michigan and schools back east. Stanford had a nice endowment, a beautiful campus, a politically weak faculty, and a lackluster scientific portfolio. But it was also situated in a region of the Bay Area that would be a major center for government-funded science, beginning in World War II and, as you know, well through the Cold War. And Frederick Terman, well, first of all, he was an engineer, which in the middle of the 20th century was kind of a trashy field relative to the other sciences. It was applied, you built bridges, you didn't have to have a BA. It was a scientific craft, in a sense, and it didn't have nearly the cachet of the other sciences. Terman, iconoclastically, created the Stanford's first PhD program in electrical engineering, much to the chagrin of the faculty in the arts and sciences. And he recognized early and well that the burgeoning technology industries in the South Bay might be well served by a flexible university that had actively courted ties with Washington and the nascent scientific funding complex of the federal government. So he inherits a kind of mediocre but pretty university. He's ambitious in a sort of lower status domain of science at the time. He sees that there's private capital in the South Bay, as well as Stanford's access to the federal government. And he was very creative in figuring out how Stanford's status betwixt and between Washington and industry might be used to leverage Stanford's own good fortune. A former student of mine who's now at Princeton and I are working on a paper on another one of Terman's many interesting ideas. It was called the Honors Cooperative Program, HCP. It was created in 1954. This is a deal. I hope you're sitting down because this is a good one. Okay, it's 1954, right? The early days of Cold War massification, when anything called science will probably be paid for by the federal government, and it will probably help us defeat communism. All right, so there's sort of massive tidal waves of money coming in from the federal government to the San Francisco Bay Area, certainly Berkeley and Stanford. A tidal wave of money, massive growth in the electronics and allied defense industries in the region, and a kind of overnight undersupply of skilled engineers. Terman recognizes an opportunity. He goes to South Bay employers who need engineers, and he says, tell you what, you need more engineers yesterday. You can source that talent from the ranks of the employees that you already have, and you can send them to Stanford via correspondence and evening courses, and we'll call it the Honors Cooperative Program, and they can earn master's degrees in education. And we'll charge you twice as much as we charge on-campus students, because it's really a special bespoke program just for you guys, and you have plenty of money. And they loved it. They even the corporations even shared admissions protocols with Stanford. So beginning in 1954, you have a nascent distance learning program funded mostly by industry to serve industry's needs in the School of Engineering. This sold like hotcakes. In fact, it sold so well that with the advent of the broad dissemination of television, Stanford acquired a television station in 1969, and created a regional instructional television network. Right? These are, those screens there are, provide, it's like early PowerPoint. They provided technical support and visual support for the engineering faculty member there. Mostly men. The men and women who were sitting at remote locations would see the same prompt as the on-campus folks did. And this was carried via via federally underwritten television station throughout the entire San Francisco Bay Area and from the Black Mountain transmitter. And you could see they were very conscious to make sure that there was enough air strength to get the signal to the south of Market Industrial Region, the East Bay, and of course, UC Berkeley. Thousands of students over many decades were trained in this program. And Stanford is a not-for-profit organization, but let's just say this program was revenue positive. Okay? It was revenue positive and continued well into the 2000s, into 2012. On the engineering side of the campus, it was perfectly normal for world-class engineering faculty to have a room full of people like yourself sitting in classroom and have that camera transmit my class live to men and women around the Bay Area region and worldwide, for which those people were paying a hefty premium, often sharing it with their corporation, right, with their employer. So when these two computer science professors, Daphne Kohler and Andrew Ng, decided in 2012 to convey a digitally mediated course online worldwide for free rather than with tuition attached to it, it was a completely natural extension of what engineers at Stanford had been doing for many, many years. Take your pick. You can sign up for CS106A at Stanford, the most popular undergraduate course on campus, which has an enrollment of about 600 people. So many enrolled that two auditoria need to be reserved for it, and it's simulcast in both locations, except nobody shows up because all of the lectures are digitized anyway. They do it in their bathrobes in their dorms, and the action happens with TAs, right? Or you could take the same content, right, through Coursera for a fraction of the cost. That, again, sold, quote unquote, like hotcakes, right? So what had changed at this moment? Oh, well, two things changed at this moment. One is the Silicon Valley hype machine promised us that Stanford computer scientists had solved the scale problem in higher education, right? That was a very compelling story. But the other thing that happened is that Daphne and Andrew and their colleagues, and I'm almost done, and their colleagues at Coursera had been a match to Kindling. The Kindling was the unabated rise in the cost of co-present instruction at your university and mine, and the transfer of those costs from federal government subsidy to individuals and their families. And so the MOOC mania, you know, promised a rapid solution to an ongoing cost-price problem that was just too good to be true, right? But boy, did it get our attention, right? And Stanford and Berkeley and Harvard and MIT and Michigan and Princeton and Arizona State University, all of us embarked into this new world called digital learning and made explicit commitments to leadership, entrepreneurship, and innovation in the education's digital space. MOOC mania died. We're sitting with a bunch of new capacity, and we don't know what happens next. Right? That's the moment we're at. Smiley face, anxiety, question mark. Oh, you should read my books. Right, exactly. Actually, this one came out in 2015. It's a collection of essays that may be useful. And this I want to plug because it's coming out in the spring by my colleagues at Stanford, Dick Scott and Michael Kirst. This is a longitudinal study of the regional higher education ecosystem in the San Francisco Bay Area and the remarkable ways in which it has grown and changed over time. Oh, good. Okay. Yeah. Diana?
Mitchell and I did not compare notes before today. And one of the things that you'll discover, that we're discovering, is we're comparing Stanford and Berkeley, but it's also kind of a stark contrast between a faculty presentation and an administrator's viewpoint in terms of the development of distance learning. So because the history, actually, Mitchell alluded to, is not unlike, it was similar in the development of both universities. So I kind of whipped through the history and didn't go into, so where we came from, radio and television, so UCTV, the Stanford Television Network, correspondence courses, remember those, taped video, live streaming, web conferencing, voiceover, PowerPoint, some of those things are still in use very effectively today. The difference in what we're doing today is, in my opinion, is the added emphasis on impact. And so there's a lot of tools and technology designed to help design interactive, engaging online content and hybrid courses. Where we're going, so Mitchell mentioned this idea of, you know, for-profit schools, and this quote came from a Pearson ad in Inside Higher Ed. And I actually liked it, and I needed to give credit where credit was due. But it's clear that while educators are the driving force behind changes in education, students are using technology to personalize their learning experience. So what I thought I'd try to talk about a little bit in terms of the changes that we've been seeing at Berkeley is I took kind of a thought, if I could, and there are a lot of faculty in this room, thinking about a faculty-centered approach, but also the student-centric approach and how that's kind of changed the way we do things. So student-centric, and here's the administrator in me, I love numbers. So MOOCs, 2.8 million enrollments in Berkeley, in 55 Berkeley X courses. 28,000 of those are verified enrollments. And for those of you who are familiar with edX MOOC and Coursera MOOCs, you can actually pay, and if you complete a short series of courses, you earn a verified certificate. Extension experimented with the Marketing Analytics X series. It's a series of short four courses with 74,000 enrollments in those. And 3,500 students completed. So even though it's only a 5% completion rate, I can tell you that 3,500 students is a lot more students completing that than they would through a traditional extension online or on-ground certificate program. So we're thrilled by that impact and access. So degrees, and I should say, I just got an update this morning. These figures are only slightly outdated. They're from 2016, but we have, so my figures show 522 students enrolled in our two biggest online degree programs at Berkeley. One is the Master's in Public Health, and the other is the Master's in Information and Data Science offered by the Information School. The Information School actually has more like 378 students now. I think I have that figure right. So it's growing. Similarly, certificates in individual courses, Extension has about 12,500 enrollments, and Summer Sessions has 2,000, and those figures are also from 2016. I lumped those together, by the way, because individual courses make up certificate programs, and it's sometimes actually impossible to distinguish, to pull out the certificate students because they're taking courses along the way and they may or may not be enrolled in the certificate program. So from the faculty standpoint and from our standpoint, it's all about the content. It's critically important. But then what do we do with it? You know, how do we use instructional design and everything else to make it engaging for the students? So we think about who the multiple audiences are, and you'll note that the traditional classroom course is one of the circles that we think faculty online content affects, because we know that faculty who have developed online content are using it bringing it into their classroom course and using it very effectively. What do we mean by multi-channel approach? And this is not just from a financial investment or business perspective. It's also a notion that online content, once it's developed, can be adapted and customized. And the Goldman School, I wanted to highlight, because they're doing something really interesting with their Masters of Public Affairs. It's a one-year hybrid program where the summer is in residence, and then students have a choice between online or in residence for the other two terms. They developed two MOOCs, and they are using them in their degree program. And that's a first, as far as I know, at Berkeley, right? So one is a small private, so those of you who have heard the term SPOC, small private online course, as they're using the MOOC content and privatizing it for their degree students. B courses, which is the tool that UC Berkeley supports on the Canvas platform, and they're using a mix of synchronous and asynchronous delivery. And then I love that they are, so think about that last slide where we were talking about multi-channel. They're leveraging courses across the campus, online courses across the campus, because it opens up the menu of options for students to take electives for their degree program. So even they identified a few extension online courses, for example, that it might make sense for a degree student to take. These two MOOCs, I won't go into detail, but these are the ones that they did. They have a very famous eightfold path method that they developed into a MOOC. I know the Burko team, the instructional design team, did an amazing job, because imagine working with eight different faculty to develop one course. That was fun. But you can see some of the folks who were involved, Robert Reich and Granholm and others. And they were thrilled with 7,600 enrollments and students earning a certificate as well. So they are really thinking about ways to get that content out there. And then the small private online course is a math review for the students in the degree program who need it. This is a shout out to our Berkeley Educational Technology Services team, the vision provided by Glenda Hull and Greg Niemeyer. Glenda is in education, Greg is Center for New Media. They had kind of independent but merging visions, where they really wanted to think about the use of technology to enable students to contribute to each other's thinking and for discussion, and for them to be able to remix their own content, so to customize their own learning. And ETS and some folks with the UC Online initiative, UC ILTI, UCOP's system-wide initiative, worked together to develop three tools. These are known as Suite C, and it's a digital asset library. So all the content, you know, is accessible to everyone, all the students and the instructors. An online interactive whiteboard. I wish we had more time. These are really cool things to demo. And a leaderboard for measuring student engagement. And we all know the importance that data comes to play. So if you get a chance, these are the links to some of the use cases for these tools, and they are readily accessible at Berkeley for faculty to use. So I was trying to think of the major takeaways from Berkeley's approach, but I actually think we share that thinking, Mitchell, which is how to think about using technology, you know, the way it's intended, which is new pedagogic approaches, and you know, and to think about what is the thinking behind the new pedagogic approaches. It's not that they're new, that makes it exciting. It's how does it improve teaching and learning? So some of the things that we're looking into at Berkeley, and I know Stanford is for sure, is the adaptive tool set and the just-in-time information that instructors and both students can have access to. What I mentioned earlier, which is the ability to adapt content for multiple audiences. We love that idea. And then the use of learning data generated to, very importantly, support student success and to further research and learning science. There are new issues cropping up all the time, as we know, when we talk about online education. And some of those are around data privacy and ownership, accessibility of the content. And finally, very intentional design that's educator-driven, you know, by the experts and by those who think really seriously about pedagogy, always keeping in mind the student and who the students are and how they learn best. So that is where we are at Berkeley.
Great. Well, as I was introduced, I'm Ben Geberman, a PhD candidate in sociology here. And I have had a longstanding interest in higher education. And in 2012, when I was looking for a dissertation topic, this MOOC mania sort of emerged. And I noticed that elite administrators and administrators on campuses across the country were beginning to ask and answer questions they weren't fully prepared to deal with. And it was in that space of uncertainty that I thought I'd have a really good opportunity to understand organizational decision making and kind of the nature and the synthetic self-understanding of these institutions, which are broad, complicated, multifaceted, doing lots of different things simultaneously. So that brought me to this topic. And as such, I've probably been a part of, a few hundred forums like this, sitting in the audience, trying to discern how these things were playing out on individual schools. And I'm happy to say those two presentations were among the better ones I've seen. We got a lot of real meat, both historical and practical, to make sense of. And so what I'd like to do is draw out a few of the parallels before we open it up for a conversation to the audience. And I guess I'll start with something that is at the core of the mission of these organizations, which is undergraduate education. A lot of the experiments that we've talked about have been in industry partnerships or sort of extension or in master's programs. And we've had a lot of effort to experiment with new possibilities. I wonder how much those things have touched undergraduate education or may touch undergraduate education at your respective campuses.
You want us to talk?
Okay. Yeah, that's the...
Yeah. So in my prior life, I was a student of elite undergraduate programs before MOOC mania happened. Undergraduates at highly selective schools like Berkeley and Stanford, they're sacred objects, essentially. They're the kind of symbolic core of the university. They provide the network the intergenerational networking DNA that as my colleague Carolyn Hawksby has amply demonstrated, systematically produces financial generosity over time. They are, central to the way in which upper middle class Americans meet one another, fall in love, get married, and choose first, second, and third mates. They also are very important indices of an institution's prestige. So Stanford, admits fewer than 5% of the undergraduates who currently apply for admission. That is a central metric to, for better or worse, it's a measure of organizational excellence in the United States. So the undergraduates matter on multiple dimensions completely independently of the sort of instructional or pedagogical purposes of the university. And in fact, I know you're sitting down, it is also the case that paying attention to undergraduates and enabling faculty to pursue research often systematically work at cross purposes from each other. All right, so I think it's important to pull out the undergraduates as a sort of special creatures in the firmament of elite higher education. And I think that is where most of the anxiety is at present, because at least at my campus, what I'm finding is expanding professional degree programs, lifelong learning, executive education, Abu Dhabi campuses, fine. Just don't, like, let the humanists hang on to the undergraduates and everything will be fine, right? And so I think what's interesting at this moment is a question of, how much of this stuff are we going to let touch the undergraduates? How much of it must we let touch the undergraduates because we might be better teachers with it, or because they expect it in ways that we don't currently recognize? But I mean, I think thinking in a figure and ground kind of way about those programs versus the others is really important.
So Berkeley is pretty much in that exact same place, I would say. And Ben's comment is right on, which is what I neglected to say in the history of distance learning at Berkeley is it started at Extension,
right?
Probably back in the 30s and 40s with correspondence, I'm thinking. Yeah. So it's been an interesting road to work with campus faculty who are interested in exploring technology to use in their as a tool for their teaching. And very much it has been, in terms of campus students, it's very much been in the professional master's degree world. Mm-hmm. And I know executive education, professional education. Mm-hmm. So what is going on at the undergraduate level, ETS and Center for Teaching and Learning, Berko, and some deans of departments who are interested in kind of pushing, testing that and pushing the envelope. What we would like to do more is, because the undergraduates are now starting to expect it.
Yeah, right.
So think of this student-centered approach. What are we doing to meet them and their needs when they're coming into Stanford and Berkeley? And right now, you know, and maybe it will be longer, Mitchell, I don't know. There is just such a love of the place and the love of the tradition, you know, and the standards and everything we know these two institutions stand for, that it's hard for even some of us who are the, you know, biggest proponents of, well, gosh, we really have to move online. It's hard for us to say we absolutely have to go there or else, you know, we're going to be left behind, because I'm not sure that's the answer, and I'm not sure that's the case, because we all love our institutions for various reasons, and part of it is, you know, we're very tied to the definition of the current definition of the place. But all that being said, students are, because of the generation that they are, and those of you who have little ones know, right? They're all over the technology. That's how they are learning. So when they arrive on campus, as much as they love the place, they're like, you know, where's the course website? Right? It's becoming an expectation. And I think it's much more effective for the students to be asking for it than for, you know, the administrators to be trying to shove technology down people's throats saying, you must come on board now. And I think it's slowly happening, and because of the faculty who are willing to experiment and with their dean's encouragement, the hybrids are more and more starting to happen. And then they realize, oh, you know, it doesn't mean I'm giving up the quality that happens in my classroom. You know, there are possibilities. There are models out there that are effective.
Yeah, great. Well, I'm cognizant of the time, so I want to ask one more challenge question before we turn it over to the audience. So in my travels, I hear that online higher education can be both the solution to the problem of limited resources and a driver of cost escalation in different contexts. So what I'd like to know is, from the perspective of Berkeley, if tomorrow we had an endowment that was quadruple the size it is today and a surplus in our operating budget, we can all dream, right? Would we be doing more online higher education? Would we be doing less online higher education, or would we be doing it the same or different? And sort of the second half of that question to Mitchell is that if we, Stanford doesn't have this the same level of challenges that Berkeley does in that regard. What's Stanford's responsibility in that space, given the capacity to dedicate additional resources to a sort of online higher education experience that might help shape the field? So I'd like to hear from both of you about resources in there.
Mm-hmm. At Berkeley, that's a great question. First, we would pay off our deficit. And with online, I have two observations. One is what I said earlier about encouraging faculty, especially those who teach undergraduates, to start experimenting. We don't have enough funding to do that. So I think that would be a great use. What I don't envision happening necessarily if we had a windfall is I don't envision running around going on a shopping spree for new systems and new technology and all this, right? I do see that we always want to keep, you know, the best talent who are supporting faculty. That's important to me. I think it's more doing more of what we already do. So what we're already doing, I don't know that a lot of, you know, a ton of money would, believe it or not, I don't know that it would improve it, because I think that we are very careful in choosing, you know, tools, because we don't think it's all about the tools. But I think we could use, you know, some things that would not just improve our infrastructure, but also help to get the word out. So when you get me thinking about online technology, you know, part of Berkeley's challenge is, you know, getting the literally communication to our campus community and to the community about what is available at Berkeley and what could be done to improve education and learning. And I would have to say funding for faculty for research would be great.
Two things. I know what Stanford is doing. It's doing what it has always done. It's going to industry and it's saying, industry, what do you need? What would you like us to build for you, with you, with your patronage? Tell us. Let's work something out. That's how Stanford is moving into the digital future. Frankly, I think it's a newly important strategy for all kinds of colleges and universities, because the public funds that built our institutions in the middle of the 20th century will not be as generous in the next 25 years as they were over the past 25 years. So we all have to find new patrons and new clients. That said, my own ambition and conviction at Stanford, and shared by several, is that in the recent decades when Stanford became a world-class university, it could presume that the state of California was providing the most accessible and highest quality public higher education system in world history to the other residents of California. So we really didn't have to think about our regional contributions. That was being taken care of by other entities and other politics. And now we're at a moment where neither Stanford nor Berkeley can presume
that the kinds of educational opportunity that taxpayers in California paid for many years can sustain our region going forward. And so I think Stanford is in an interesting moment where I think it might be coaxed into thinking about new ventures that would enable an opening of educational opportunity for a wider swath of Californians. And boy, I'm looking for as many good ideas as I can in that regard.
Great. Well, it would be great if we heard some questions from the audience. Would you, Diane has the microphone. I'm happy to start the queue. Should we start in the back there?
Hi.
Yes. Oh. Please do state your name and affiliation. If you
okay, wonderful presentation. I'm Jian Sheng Guo. I'm a faculty in CSU East Bay, California State University East Bay. I teach a lot of online courses as well. So I've got a question about the, if you look at the society, and we are much more going to the distant mobile digital in terms of taxis, banking, purchasing, and everything. And higher education seems to be really way behind this trend. So my question is, do you think that this is really, we are still holding the last stronghold of the essence of the society, conscience of the society, or we have become a reactionary, kind of a conservative force of this society due to whatever reasons? And I just wonder whether you have any comments.
Higher education in the United States is a many-splendored thing, okay? There are 4,500 colleges and universities at last count, right? We're a nation of school builders. You might be able to say that about Stanford. I don't think you can say that about Arizona State University in Phoenix. I think Michael Crow and his colleagues at ASU are building a new American university, and they're going a lot faster, frankly, than Stanford is. Innovative Stanford, right? So I think it depends on where you look. The legacy brands like yours and mine are in a very complicated position. They have a lot of reason to be risk averse. I would like to think that we could use our legacies and our resources and our intelligence to be more critical and optimistic and experimental going forward. I would like to think that I can encourage my university to do that. But the future of higher education is going to be built on multiple platforms with or without Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Stanford, and Berkeley. So it depends on where you look, I would say.
Yeah, thanks for your question. It's a really interesting one. My response to that would be, at least for Berkeley and Stanford, we are first and foremost research universities. So with that in mind, the research, the data, can drive, you know, that type of innovation. But what we, so going back to, you know, Ben's question about undergraduate education, you know, that's a thing that we kind of have to tackle, and it comes along with our legacies, you know, and how much respect we have for our history and our legacy. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be or couldn't be. I don't think we're ever going to be an ASU. Right? Who knows? But I think we'll be different and innovative in really interesting ways that we don't know about yet.
Gentleman in the back, yes. Yes, my name is Frank Olkin. I formerly worked at Lawrence Berkeley Lab here, but my question has to do with this recent decision about the Justice Department told Berkeley that it had to caption its videos that it was putting online for the public so that they would be accessible to the deaf. And Berkeley apparently decided that they didn't want to spend the money, and so their solution was that they're going to take all these videos down and all the podcasts down so that the public won't have any access to any of this material at all. And so the logic of this somewhat escapes me, other than saving money. But my question is, the video being cheap ignores the question of captioning it. And conceivably, you could do automated captioning with speech recognition, but it's not clear if that's good enough for these purposes. So I want to know what you folks think of this and what the impact on the economics, whether you think that these sorts of court decisions are going to extend out to other universities, and what the impact of all this is.
I might add, that's a wonderful connection to a question I wasn't able to answer or ask, but what are the regulatory frontiers that you see as individual universities, and how are you preparing? But that's a key one that many of us didn't see coming, but there are many others that we'll have to think seriously about.
Do you want to go first?
Sure. Thanks, Mitchell.
I'll go first if you want.
So I was actually wondering if someone was going to ask that question, because it's something that we're struggling with. First and foremost, please know Stanford, Berkeley, everyone, all of us who are involved in MOOCs, we're all about providing access. We are all about providing as much free education to anyone and everyone that we possibly can. For free, you know, if possible. So where we got caught, and there are experts in this room who know more than I do, and should stop me if I put my foot in my mouth. So starting with that premise, then there are a couple of things that didn't make it into the news stories that have been out about the DOJ issues. One is, they're right, there were serious cost concerns for quality transcription of video. We're paying, I think, around $2 a minute. Does that sound right? And I don't even know how many tens of thousands of hours are being offered on YouTube and iTunes. The other very significant piece of data that we should keep in mind is we know the viewership of all the free YouTube videos that are out there, the lectures, and they're not watched very much. The average, I believe, is 7 minutes per video. So that was taken into consideration, is, you know, actual usage. And a lot of it are very, very old videos that were staying up there. They're not being taken down completely. My understanding is that UC Berkeley students will have access to what they need to have access to. And we, of course, provide full accommodation based on our disability services office for Berkeley students who are enrolled in a class and need accommodation. They are fully accommodated for all of their online courses that they take at Berkeley. So I don't know if that addresses your question fully, but I thought I'd take the opportunity to share a couple of points that may or may not be widely known.
Okay, great. I'd say very briefly, I won't respond to your question directly, though I did do homework on precisely that because we thought someone would ask that question. Happy to talk to you about it at lunch. In terms of governance, this is the Wild West, man. This is totally open, because now, when teaching and learning happen through digital media, there are clickstream level traces of every single interaction that every single learner and every single instructor has. That has never happened before. So we have a whole system of governance which is predicated on me, the faculty member, conveying my class to my students in my classroom, and you can visit every now and again if I say it's okay. Right? That world has not disappeared
But even my classroom is now a joint venture with the Learning Management System, which is a publicly traded company, with Piazza, which is a for-profit startup that that many faculty use at their discretion, with the company that collects keystrokes in the cafeteria, right, at Stanford, which may also be a third-party vendor, right? How does all that stuff fit together? Which part of it is part of the official student record and which is not? Which part of it is private? Which part of it is at the discretion of the instructor? So this whole domain of sort of how to think about how teaching and learning is appropriately governed in a context of multiple platforms and data streams, which are easily integrable, is a spectacular ethical, I would suggest, as well as a political frontier. And I've worked with several people here at Berkeley, including Jen Sturm, and a bunch of folks nationally, to at least try to develop a fairly sophisticated conversation of what the ethical and political stakes are. We've assembled a bunch of stuff here at this website. It may inform some of this thinking going forward. But another place in which I think places like Berkeley and Stanford should be proactive in standard setting rather than reactive in response to the Justice Department or other agencies of government. Yeah. But it's expensive.
It's expensive. And we actually, it's kind of a personal note, which was I was a little bit kind of flabbergasted by the DOJ issue only because at Berko, our resource center for online education, we had actually hired a couple of folks who were so committed and passionate about this very issue, and we're completely ahead of the game and proactive in thinking about how to make our courses accessible, to the students. So, but we addressing YouTube videos and something that kind of hit us like, oh wow, all those videos are out there. That's right.
I mean, you know what they say in Silicon Valley, right? If it's free to you, then you're part of the product. Right, yeah. And so that creates a whole new set of service contractual relationships that we just haven't figured out in higher education.
Two things. First, let's give a great round of applause to our speakers. You'll have an opportunity to speak with them while you're all having lunch. Yeah. But secondly, a brief comment on coming attractions. Before we reach the spring break, which is in a few weeks from now, we're going to have two more sessions, very different topics. Next Tuesday, which is the 14th, we're going to hear from two community college professors who studied the impact of community colleges as engines of social mobility, as growth areas. It may be the largest growth area of higher education. What's happening? What are the trends? What are the problems for community colleges, which is not often discussed sometimes in major research universities. And then on the 23rd, my colleague from the Goldman School, David Kerp, who's been studying the college dropout problem, which is a huge additional problem, partly because of finance and for other reasons, he's going to be here to discuss his research. He's writing a book on the subject, so that'll be on the 23rd. And then finally, after spring break, much of April, we're going to be preoccupied with three guests, Mike McPherson, president of the Spencer Foundation and former president of McAllister College, Rick Levin, former president of Yale and head of Coursera, and Larry Bacow, former president of Tufts. All are going to speak on aspects of financial sustainability in higher education. Multiple sessions with each of those presidents in three different weeks of April. So there's plenty to keep you busy if you'd like to continue to be addicted to what we do. So thank you so much for coming and enjoy your lunch.